Very good. So after the discussion, we will get on with the subject of today's talk, which is very different from what we have discussed before. And the subject of today's lecture is neutron stars in a binary system with two neutron stars going around a common center of mass. On the 17th of August, 2 years ago, gravitational waves were detected from two neutron stars almost about to merge. We didn't detect the neutron stars as they, gravitational waves as the neutron stars merged, because the LIGO detector is not capable as yet of detecting the actual merger, but it would have merged in a millisecond or a couple of milliseconds. So the question therefore arises as, how do these binary systems form? Let's go to the beginning. Long before neutron stars were discovered, the great Zeldovich in Moscow pointed out, when neutron stars were still a hypothetical conjecture to be found only in Landau-Lipschitz statistical physics, he said, but the Russians, of course, believed in neutron stars very strongly. He said that if there is a neutron star in a binary system, why they should be in a binary system, he wasn't bothered, but that's the genius. He said, if it was in a binary system, and if some matter from the companion star fell onto the neutron star, then the gravitational binding energy will be released predominantly as X-rays. Of course, nobody paid any attention to this, because neutron stars were obviously a figment of imagination, and neutron stars and binaries are even greater fiction. But in 1962, quite by accident, a suborbital rocket flight, which just went above the atmosphere for 1 or 2 minutes, which had an X-ray detector, detected a very, very powerful X-ray source in the constellation Scorpio. Of course, astronomers are very ingenious. They called it SCO X1, the first X-ray source in Scorpio. What this source was, nobody knew. But it was soon established that whatever this source was, it was a binary, because the optical companion was detected. Professor Srikantan, who used to be the director of PIFR in Bombay, he was involved in this. He was very young at the time, and when he was in MIT in Boston. Now, after pulsars were discovered, that was 1962. Pulsars discovery were announced in February 1968. And pulsars are, of course, rotation-powered, isolated neutron stars. But after that, it became clear that SCO X1 was, in fact, a neutron star accreting gas from a companion star. Today, many hundreds of such X-ray binaries have been detected, both in our galaxy and in external galaxies, mostly by Chandra Observatory, which has the sensitivity to detect it even in external galaxies. Now, these X-ray binaries can be broadly classified as follows. There are massive X-ray binaries, where a neutron star has a massive stellar companion from which it's accreting. Then there are the low mass X-ray binaries, where a neutron star has a companion which is sun-like, namely one solar mass or thereabouts, from which it is accreting. So we now know hundreds and hundreds of these X-ray binaries. They broadly divide themselves into these two categories, massive X-ray binaries and low mass X-ray binary. Now, the subject of binary stars really came into its own only in the early 1970s. Although, when you look up at the night sky, most of the stars that you see are really binaries. You have to establish them spectroscopically, but many of them are wide binaries. They are technically binaries, but they don't have any interesting consequences arising from the fact that they are binaries. And there was one binary system known as Algol, surrounding which there was a great mystery. So let me explain to you what this mystery was. This was a binary consisting of two stars, a low mass star of about 8 solar mass, which was a helium star, very highly evolved and extremely luminous. But it had a companion which was very, very much more massive than that, 20 solar mass companion, but the companion was not evolved at all. It was like the sun, just shining. Now this is not in keeping with what we have learned about stars, Eddington's theory. Why? Please remember that more massive stars should evolve faster. So how come a 20 solar mass star has not at all evolved, whereas an 8 solar mass star has evolved, it has become a helium star, no hydrogen in it in the spectrum, only helium in the spectrum, and extremely luminous. Please remember the luminosity of a star is proportional to m to the power 3.5. m to the power 3 in Eddington's theory, this is from observation. And the lifetime of the star is mc squared divided by the luminosity, which is 1 over m to the power 2.5 approximately. Therefore, you would expect the more massive star to be more evolved than the less massive star. So this was the Algol paradox. Okay, now let's go back 250 years ago and discuss what is known as the Roche equipotentials. Now please, this is not something that you might encounter in your MSc education. That's because classical mechanics is not taught like it ought to be taught. But let us discuss very briefly. There are two stars, two objects, gravitating objects, which are the two dots in this picture. What is plotted here are gravitational equipotentials in two dimensions. Three dimensions, they will be, imagine them to be three-dimensional bodies. A gravitational equipotential means that along it, the gravitational potential is the same. Very good. So not surprisingly, around each of these stars, near the star, the gravitational potentials are circular. Or in three dimensions, there'll be spherical surfaces. Fine. But then you will also agree that when you go far away from either of the stars, you will begin to see the influence of the other star gravitationally. So at some point or other, when you go away from each of these stars, these two equipotential surfaces will intersect. And when they intersect, they will no longer be perfect circles. They'll be like balloon. If you look carefully where the balloon is tied, there will always be a deviation from sphericity. Common sense tells you that will be the case. That means if I put a test particle at the point L1, then it feels equal gravitational potential due to either of the two stars. Therefore, this point becomes a point of instability. We'll come to that in a minute. So this point is called as the inner Lagrangian point, because these things were first studied by the great mathematician Lagrange. And there are other Lagrangian points, L2, L3, L4, and L5. These are all very important for placing satellites so that you can have an uninterrupted view of the sun and things like that. But we will not get into that sort of thing. Please remember that this is a plot in the co-rotating frame. Remember, both the stars are going around a common center of mass. So I go to a frame in which the rotation is taken out, co-rotating frame. In that co-rotation frame, I've drawn these equipotential lines. Now, let us introduce the concept of Roche lobe. Roche lobe is this gravitational equipotential surface which touch at the inner Lagrangian point. So star 1 has a Roche lobe, star 2 has a Roche lobe. Common sense tells you that the size of this Roche lobe will be related to the mass of the star, because larger the mass, larger is the distance up to which its gravitational influence will be more important than the influence of its neighbor. Smaller the mass of the star is the opposite. Please remember that this figure has a rotational symmetry about the axis, which is a line joining the two stars. In other words, it's a three-dimensional figure like a balloon, which is pinched. It is not rotationally symmetric about the vertical axis because this balloon is pinched here, right? Fine. But please try to imagine that I can approximate this dashed blue line surrounding either of the two stars as roughly a sphere. Okay. In other words, I can construct a mathematical sphere whose volume is the same as the volume of this Roche lobe. The radius of that imaginary sphere is known as the Roche lobe radius. Please remember, the Roche lobe is not a sphere. Because of tidal interaction, the Roche lobe is sort of pinched there. So Roche lobe radius is the radius of a sphere which has roughly the same volume. Please remember that there is a very important consequence of what I said. Let us say that both these stars evolve. When the stars evolve, the Roche potentials will not change because the potentials are determined only by the mass of the star. It doesn't care how big the star is, because in Newton's gravity, we take all that mass to be concentrated in the center anyway. But let us say the star is evolving, so it's becoming bigger and bigger. So you notice, for example, the star on the right has become a giant due to things happening deep in the interior. The core is contracting, the star is expanding. At some stage, the star becomes a giant star and it becomes as large as its Roche lobe. Then in a little more time, the star would like to become even bigger. But if it tries to become bigger, it cannot become bigger than the Roche lobe. What will happen to all the mass? It'll flow like pressing a toothpaste tube, and the matter will go gushing towards the other star. Okay. So the important thing that I have said so far is that a star can never become larger than its own Roche lobe, because if it did that, and it will do that because it is driven by what's happening in the center, then mass will flow to the other star. So we have introduced the notion of mass transfer from star A to star B. Now, since this matter has angular momentum, because we are discussing a binary, it cannot fall radially into that other star. So it will come near the other star, form an accretion disk, like the rings of Saturn, from which it may or may not fall onto the companion star or just hang around in the disk. We'll come to the story later on today. So let's look at it slightly differently. Let us plot the gravitational potential 1 over r of the two stars as we normally do. Remember, what we do in a solid is you have two atoms. This is the nuclear potential. And then when I bring two atoms together, these nuclear potentials overlap. And then what we say is that as long as electrons are over here, they are still bound to individual nuclei. But over here, the electrons become free, and they become free electrons in metals. So in the same way, in this representation of the Roche potentials, as the star evolves, it is extending to larger and larger radius, which is the x coordinate in this diagram. So at some stage, star A will overflow its Roche potential, Roche lobe, and matter will be transferred till an equilibrium is attained. Okay, so you decide which way you feel more comfortable in trying to understand the concept of critical Roche lobe and the concept of mass transfer. Okay, you need to think a little bit about it if you have not encountered these things before. Now let us consider the evolution of a binary system, which consists of two stars, one which is 25 solar mass and one which is 10 solar mass. Why 25 and 10? Because the person who has done this computer calculations chose 25 and 10. Okay, and I've taken this figure from a particular paper where this choice was done. There's nothing sacred about this. And you'll see in a minute why this person chose that particular mass. To draw figures, he would have done all kinds of masses, but why did he choose to do that? He'll come to in a minute. So at time t equal to zero, you have an orbital period of 5 days, and you have two stars, 25 solar mass and 10 solar mass, both well inside their respective Roche lobes. The more massive star should evolve faster, according to Eddington, and therefore the 25 solar mass star will fill its Roche lobe, and the second star is still well inside the Roche lobe. Now, at this stage, matter will be transferred from the more massive star to the less massive star. At some stage, the masses will become equal, and beyond that point, the mass donor star will actually be less massive. There's nothing wrong about it. It's only less massive because it got rid of the outer envelope. But as far as the central engine goes, it is the engine of a massive star, so it is producing nuclear energy like mad, becoming more and more luminous. Okay, so don't get confused between the star's mass decrease, because what is left is what counts for a star, all right? Fine. So at some stage, I want to submit to you that the star which is donating mass will become the less massive star. Okay, now here is a problem for you. Two simple problems in Newtonian mechanics, please do them, because then only you will understand this. Let us consider what is known as conservative mass transfer. That is, mass is only transferred from A to B. It is not lost from the system. Maybe in real system, some mass may be lost from the system, but we only know to do simple problems. We will assume it is not lost from the system, just to make life easier for you. Convince yourself of the following. Problem number one. When a more massive star transfers mass to the companion, the orbit will shrink. This follows simply from conservation of angular momentum. So take Newton's mechanics. It's a two-body problem. It can be reduced to a one-body problem, chapter two of Goldstein, and then show that the orbit will shrink. Conversely, when the mass donor is the less massive star, the orbit will expand. Prove these two very simple theorems. It shouldn't take more than about 5 minutes. Okay, so now let's go back to our original system. Now you see the more massive star on the left has become an 8.5 solar mass star, and the star which was originally 10 solar mass on the right has now gathered more mass, and it has now become the more massive star with a mass of 26.5. The sum of the two masses remains the same as original, 35 solar mass. But you notice the orbital period is not 5 days anymore, but the orbital period is 7 days. Okay. That's because originally when it was massive, the orbit would have shrunk, and then when it became less massive, the orbit has expanded. So the final system is wider than the original system. Don't worry about the numbers there. I just want you to notice that the binary is in fact wider as part of your problem. To show initially it would have shrunk and then eventually it would expand. So finally, this 8.5 solar mass star and 26.5 solar mass star, let us look at it very carefully. The 8.5 solar mass star is a very luminous star, because what remains of it is essentially the inner regions of the original 25 solar mass star. All the hydrogen envelope is gone. What is left is a helium star. That is our Algol system. The Algol system consists of an 8 solar mass ultra-luminous helium star with an unevolved, more massive companion star. So the Algol paradox was finally understood around 1970, in terms of this mass transfer picture, there is nothing unusual about it. There is no violation or deviation from Eddington's theory of the stars. Fine. Very good. So we leave the Algol paradox behind. It's well understood. It's no longer a mystery. Now let's continue with the story. Now that 8.5 solar mass helium star will evolve very rapidly and soon explode as a supernova explosion, leaving behind a neutron star whose mass is 1.4 solar mass. Okay, so what is left is 1.4 solar mass, and then the companion star is 26.5 solar mass. The remaining mass of 7 solar mass has been ejected when the supernova explosion took place. Now here is problem number 3 for you in elementary Newtonian mechanics. Will the supernova disrupt the binary? After all, suddenly you have ejected mass. Will it disrupt the binary? Okay. So here is a problem for you. I'll tell you how to solve it. First, let me state to you what the result is. Let us consider two stars of mass, original mass, M1 and M2. Let us say the star M1 explodes and ejects a mass delta M. So what is remaining is M1 minus delta M. And that ejector will expand spherically about that star, and soon it will engulf the companion star, and the supernova remnant will become bigger and bigger and become many light years in size, given hundreds of thousands of years. So here is the situation. A mass delta M has been ejected in this simple picture, spherically, symmetrically, just to make the problem very simple. Okay. So do this following problem. Assume the star M1 ejects a mass delta M instantaneously. Let it not be a very gradual thing. After all, a supernova explosion is a more or less an instantaneous thing. Assume that the explosion is spherically symmetric. Again, the problem becomes very easy if it is spherically symmetric. I mean, the real explosion may or may not be spherically symmetric, but you do the same. Show that the condition for disruption of the binary is that the mass ejected delta M must be greater than 1/2 the initial total mass. Remember, the original masses were M1 and M2. So the statement in Newton's mechanics is the binary will be disrupted if mass ejected delta M is greater than 1/2 the initial total mass. Okay? So prove this theorem. You'll learn a lot about two-body problems. Good. So I'll assume that you have done it. Right, fine. So now let's go back and ask the question. I glibly said that this 8.5 solar mass helium star will explode as a supernova, leaving behind a neutron star and a companion. You have to now ask the question, is the supernova likely to have disrupted the binary? And the answer is no. See, let us look at this. The original mass is 8.5 plus 26.5, which is our 35 solar mass, 25 plus 10, fine. So half of that is 17.5. The mass ejected is only 7 solar mass, because 8.5 solar mass, what remains is a neutron star of 1.4 solar mass, so what is ejected is only 7 solar mass. So 7 is less than 17, and therefore the binary will not be disrupted, and our story can continue. The binary disrupted, then our story cannot continue, all right? So no question of having two neutron stars in a binary. But what we are saying is, don't worry about it. Go get on with the story and see if you get two neutron stars. So binary will not be disrupted during the first supernova explosion. You may remember the second star, which is now normal, shining like the sun, hydrogen being converted to helium, will someday explode as a supernova. Then you have to ask this question again. Will the binary survive that second explosion? We'll come to that in a minute. But let's continue with this story. Now, a neutron star has been born on the left, and the companion star, like the Sun, is still well inside its Roche lobe. Gone back, I don't know. Finger, I think there. The companion star is still unevolved, but there is a stellar wind emanating from it. There is a wind from the Sun we are bombarded with every second. It's called the solar wind. Why gas is able to acquire velocity greater than the escape velocity of the Sun is a different problem. Okay? That was solved by one of my teachers, Eugene Parker. There is now a satellite entering the Sun's outer atmosphere named after him. Parker is still alive. So what will happen is, when this neutron star captures some of this mass from the companion, like the Earth is capturing some of the mass that is coming from the Sun, it will become an X-ray source. So the gravitational potential energy will be converted to radiation, and the radiation will be in X-rays. Why X-rays? I leave it to you to figure it out. So if I have a neutron star, you know all about a neutron star. You know its radius is about 10 kilometers, and its mass is about one solar mass. So if I put a, if I drop a particle there, gravitational potential energy is gm over r squared, gm over r energy. Convince yourself that this is roughly 10% of rest mass energy. Multiply, divide by c and so on, and you know the radius of the star is about 10 kilometers. If you put in the number capital G and so on, you'll find that the gravitational potential energy is roughly 10% of the rest mass energy. The rest mass energy of the electron is 500,000 electron volt. So 10% is 50 kilo electron volts, and 50 kilo electron volts is X-rays. So if it rains on the neutron star, the gravitational potential energy will come out as X-rays, right? So that's where the X-rays come from. So we will revisit this presently. Then eventually the companion star, 26 solar mass star, will evolve, become a giant, and this time it will transfer mass like mad to the neutron star, and we will be interested in knowing what the neutron star does, what will happen to it. That's the story today, but and tomorrow and the day after. But for the moment, let's just say that this is going to happen. Because the more massive star is transferring mass, the orbit will shrink. As the orbit shrinks, the Roche lobe will become smaller. So more matter will fall, so it is a positive feedback. So when a more massive star transfers mass to a less massive star, it's a positive feedback, namely the mass transfer will become faster and faster and faster because you're squeezing the toothpaste tube more and more and more. What is squeezing is the Roche lobe is getting smaller and smaller because the orbit is shrinking. So it's an unstable mass transfer. So if you want to have a stable mass transfer lasting for a very long time, you must make sure that the orbit doesn't shrink. Okay, that will become important when we discuss millisecond pulsars next week. So the end result is, at some stage, the companion star will become just a helium star. It will lose all its hydrogen envelope. It's gone. Some of it accepted by the neutron star, but most of it will leave the system because the neutron star cannot accept it, and it will explode as a supernova. Now, this time, let's do that calculation once again. You have an 8 solar mass star. The original mass is 10 solar mass. Okay, the original mass is 10 solar mass, M1 plus M2. And what is delta M? 8.8 minus 1.4 is 7 solar mass. So 7 solar mass is greater than 1/2 of 10 solar mass. Therefore, the binary will disrupt during the second supernova explosion. But in very rare circumstance, if the explosion of the second star is asymmetric, for reasons, you just wave your hands and say, if it is asymmetric, then maybe the binary could survive. It has to be a conspiracy. It has to be a tremendous conspiracy to make the binary survive the second supernova explosion. Okay? So if there is such a tremendous conspiracy, then you will have a binary neutron star system where two neutron stars are going around each other, and you will expect the orbit to be elliptical, because in the supernova explosion, particularly if it is asymmetric, there's no reason why the orbit should be perfectly circular. So common sense tells you, if at all the binary survives, it will be a highly elliptical orbit. Okay, extreme ellipticity is same as binary disruption. But in the majority of cases, the binary will in fact disrupt, and you'll have two neutron stars going in exactly opposite directions from conservation of momentum considerations. So let us summarize. This picture summarizes everything that I have said so far about the evolution of massive binary. By the way, the choice of 25 and 10 solar mass was because it produced the Algol parameters of 8 solar mass and 26 solar mass star. Okay? But people have done calculations. You name the mass ratio, they will do the calculation. These pictures are drawn from real computer calculations, evolution. So the first neutron star is born when the original massive star explodes as a supernova. Then there is a weak stellar wind from the companion star. At that stage, the neutron star turns on as an X-ray source. And then during the evolution of the companion star, there'll be heavy accretion onto the neutron star. And the second star will ultimately end its life as a supernova explosion, the second supernova in the binary system. In the majority of cases, the binary will be disrupted. But in rare cases, the binary will remain intact. So that's the prediction, right? Fine. Our story begins in 1974, when Joe Taylor and his student Hulls discovered a remarkable system of two neutron stars going around each other. And at that time, I had just come to the Raman Institute from the Cavendish Laboratory in Cambridge. And till then, I was working in solid state physics, as it used to be called those days. And that's when I got interested in astronomy, because this posed a serious puzzle. But before the puzzle, let us, which is the next lecture basically, let us discuss what kind of a system this was. Now, what was clear is that although there are two neutron stars going around the common center of mass, only one neutron star is beaming towards us. In other words, we saw only one of them acting as a lighthouse. The other one presumably is also a pulsar, but that beam is not pointing towards us. Could have pointed towards us if you are lucky, but it wasn't. Oh, I see. Okay, it will probably come back. Then it will go down. Okay. I hope you can still see the screen. Now, how do we know, if you see only one neutron star as a pulsar, how do you conclude it's a binary? Okay, pulsars are clocks. They go tick, tick. The pulses come once every rotation. Now, clearly, if that neutron star is going around the center of mass, then the period of that pulse will be modulated due to Doppler shift. As the pulsar is coming towards you, the period will become shorter. As it's moving away from you, the period will become longer. And what you would expect is, if the orbit is circular, then what you would expect is the period of rotation of the pulsar will vary as a sine wave. If it is a circular, so if you detect this Doppler motion, then you know it's in a binary. Okay. So that is how it was deduced that it was in a binary. But it was also deduced that it was a highly eccentric binary. That's because if you actually plot the radial velocity, which is delta P is V over C according to Doppler's formula. So what you're really plotting is the radial velocity of the neutron star going around the common center of mass. You see it is not sinusoidal. It has all kinds of harmonics present in it. If I were to Fourier analyze it, it'll have fundamental and many harmonics. Another way of saying that is the orbit is not circular orbit, it's highly eccentric. You can try to fit it, which is what the solid curve has done to the data, and then you can actually solve for the eccentricity. And it turned out to be highly eccentric orbit. Eccentricity was 0.7. So here is the system that we see. Those are the coordinates of the pulsar. Don't worry about it. The period of rotation of the neutron star is 59 milliseconds. It's rotating very, very rapidly. Crab pulsar is rotating at 33 milliseconds. This is rotating about double the period, very, very rapid. The period derivative of this pulsar was extremely small. In other words, the derived magnetic field, remember the magnetic field is square root of P times period derivative. And that was very, very small. As I told you, most of the 2,500 pulsars that we know, the magnetic field is around 10 to the power 13 Gauss, but the magnetic field of this pulsar was several orders of magnitude smaller. And its orbital period is less than 8 hours, and the eccentricity 0.6. So can you imagine two stars of mass 1.4 solar mass going around each other once every 7 hours? Unbelievable, absolutely unbelievable. Can you imagine what kind of a strong gravity effects there will be? Naturally, first thing that will occur to you is, can I use this as a laboratory for testing predictions of general theory of relativity? After all, I have two solar mass objects going around each other with an orbital period of 7 hours. And in a solar system where all the tests were done before, we have this miserable planet Mercury at some enormous distance from the sun, going around once in so many, 1 year or whatever is the orbital period. So you would expect relativistic effects to be very much more prominent in this system than in solar system where the previous verifications had been done. Let us pause for a minute. After all, we discussed Einstein's general theory of relativity. Let us recall once again that when Einstein formulated his new theory of gravity, it was because he felt that Newton's law of gravity must be wrong because it assumes instantaneous propagation of gravitational influence. What is that? But there was no known violation of Newton's law of gravity, except one. And there was a tiny, tiny deviation, and that had to do with the precession of the orbit of Mercury. But it was just one part in a million or something like that. So if you want to be really fussy, you can say, there is this one thing where Newton's law doesn't correctly explain the motion of planets. But other than that, there was absolutely no known violation of Newton's law. So let's try to understand why an orbit precesses in Einstein's theory of gravity. Okay? Fine. I don't know whether you people have studied this, but let's not make a big song and dance about it, because you really don't have to know general relativity to understand why the orbit precesses. It is enough to know an approximate version of general relativity. So let's try to understand this, cut out all the mathematics, and try to understand why an orbit is an ellipse in Newton's theory. Goldstein chapter 2 or whatever, right? So let us go back to Newton's theory and recall the concept of an effective potential in Newton's theory. What is shown on the left on the top is the kinetic energy of a test mass, the gravitational potential energy, and therefore the total energy. And what is shown in green is the angular momentum of the planet. So don't bother with all the mathematics that is written here. These are all standard things from elementary mechanics. But just look at the picture that I have plotted. What is plotted on the y-axis is the potential energy, and plotted on the x-axis is the, let us say, the semi-major axis of the orbit. A curve on the top, a curve on the bottom, is the gravitational potential energy minus gm over r. So 1 over r potential goes to minus infinity as r tends to 0. What is shown as a dashed line on the top is the centrifugal barrier. L over mr squared. One is the minus gm over r. The second is L squared, where L is angular momentum, L squared divided by 2mr squared. Therefore, if I add the two terms, I find, like a nuclear potential or an intermolecular potential, you find a characteristic curve, which is a minimum. This is Newton's theory of gravity. So what kind of orbits does this problem give you? Well, let us consider a planet at the minimum of this effective potential. Effective potential is the sum of the gravitational potential plus centrifugal potential. So let's consider this planet, the red dot, at the minimum. Then it is going around in a circular orbit. The orbit is a circle of symmetry. But then this particle can also execute simple harmonic motion about this minimum. So there are two motions. There is a circular motion due to azimuthal motion, and then there is an in-out radial motion in this effective potential. So that is the circular orbit, and that is an elliptical orbit. Why is it an elliptical orbit, if I take both into account? For the very simple and very beautiful reason, which is an extraordinary accident of inverse square law. The accident is the following. It's very elementary to calculate what will be the orbit of the circular period of the circular orbit. Let's call it omega. It is also very elementary to calculate what will be the period of this simple harmonic radial motion. Its frequency is omega prime. It turns out that omega is exactly equal to omega prime. So the period of the azimuthal motion is exactly the same as the period of the in and out motion, which is why the orbit is a closed ellipse. If omega is not equal to omega prime, it will not be a closed ellipse. Okay. So it is an extraordinary accident of inverse square law that the in and out motion superimposed on the circular motion produces closed elliptical orbit, namely the Kepler ellipses. It is an accident of the 1 over r squared effective potential that these two periods are the same. Okay, fine. And you know how to, it is this coincidence that produces the elliptical orbits of Kepler. So now let us plot the effective potential in Einstein's theory of gravity. What is shown on the right is what we just discussed, the Newtonian effective potential. For various values of angular momentum, you have various curves all having a minimum. But in Einstein's theory of gravity, instead of gm over r, I have 1 minus rg divided by r, or 1 minus 2gm divided by rc square. Okay, that's what it is. Therefore, if masses are very small, or if radius is very, very, distances are very, very large, then you notice you can recover the Newtonian potential, but there is no guarantee that it will always be Newtonian. And that, of course, is the effect of curvature of space coming in there. So you see, as r becomes closer and closer to 2gm over c squared, which we will identify next week as the radius of the black hole or the Schwarzschild radius, as r approaches the Schwarzschild radius, the first factor is no longer 1, so it is 1 minus something, therefore it is much less than 1. And therefore, the effective potential in Einstein's theory at short distances as a maximum coming out of that. Okay. So on the left you have Einstein's potential, on the right you have Newton's potential. But don't worry about the maximum, we are not discussing it now, we will discuss it when we come to black hole. But I just want to look at the minimum in Newton's potential and the minimum in Einstein's potential. You notice that the curves look different. In one case, I can fit a nice parabola to Newton's minimum. Near the minimum, I can fit a parabola, and therefore motions are simple harmonic. But you look at the picture on the left, it's like an unharmonic potential of a molecule, a diatomic molecule. Here it is slow, here it is rising fast. So you cannot very easily fit a parabola to it. Another way of saying that is, please notice that the effective potential is a 1 over r cubed term in it. It has a 1 over r squared term and it has a 1 over r cubed term. That comes essentially from general relativity or modification of Newton's theory. We are not using the full general relativity here, but modifications of Newton's gravity. So, once again, notice that in Einstein's theory of gravity, the effective potential as a 1 over r squared term like in Newton's theory, but it is a 1 over r cubed correction. It's a very small correction. In this potential, the period of the in-out motion is no longer equal to the period of the circular motion. I leave it as a very simple problem to show. It has nothing to do with general relativity. You know, accept this potential, take this potential, don't ask where it came from. Just calculate, you know, given a potential, how to calculate the frequency of simple harmonic motion. Calculate the oscillation period and show that these two frequencies are not exactly the same. This means the ellipse is not closed. In other words, the ellipse precesses. So this was Einstein's main result in his paper on general theory of relativity. Please remember, Einstein did not have a solution to his equation. He had only the equation. The solution was discovered by Schwarzschild. But in his discovery paper, he produced an approximate solution in the limit of weak gravity, where Newton's law is only is a very good approximation. And there he calculated the precession of the perihelion, periastron of the Mercury orbit. So let's summarize what is the orbit in Einstein's theory. What is plotted in the central inset is the effective potential in Einstein's gravity. A planet at point one, minimum of the potential, will execute a perfectly circular orbit that is allowed even in general relativity. But if you now perturb it and if you allow an in and out radial motion, which is two, then the orbit is a stable precessing ellipse. Ellipse is not closed because the two frequencies are not the same. And we won't worry about the other two things. So Einstein calculated the precession of the periastron of Mercury in an approximate manner in his theory, because he could only solve his equations in an approximate manner at that time. Here are the facts. The major axis of Mercury precesses at a mad rate, at 574 arc seconds per century. But much of this is nothing to do with Newton being wrong. That was a two-body problem we have discussed. But there are other planets. The perturbations of the other planets makes the orbit precess. And this was understood 150 years before Einstein came along. But the perturbation of other planets produce only 531 out of the 574 arc second per century. So there was this tiny amount of 43 arc seconds per century. So in 100 years, the perihelion of the orbit advances by 43 seconds of arc. So it's a very, very, very small deviation from Newton's theory. In his paper of November 2015, Einstein calculated about 45 arc second, which is spectacular success. So this is what Einstein said. He wrote to a friend, "For a few days, I was beside myself with joyous excitement. The discovery has given me palpitations of the heart. I had a feeling that something actually snapped in me." This is what convinced him that his new theory of gravity was correct. So the other tests had to wait for a long time. Now, contrast this with the binary neutron star system that we discussed. The precession of perihelion of Mercury is 43 seconds of arc per century, whereas it is 4.2 degrees per year for the binary pulsar. Imagine how the jumbo effect is, 4.2 degrees. So I hope it is clear to you now why in relativistic theory of gravity, the orbit is not a closed ellipse. So if somebody asks you, cut out all the mathematics, and all you have to say is, the effective potential, which is the sum of gravitational potential plus centrifugal potential, admits of two motions. One is an azimuthal motion, which is a circular orbit, and in and out radial motion, whose period is no longer equal to the period of the circular orbit. Therefore, the circle becomes an ellipse, but the ellipse is not closed. So it's as simple as that. So now let's discuss gravitational radiation from these two neutron stars. How do we know the other star is a neutron star? We haven't seen it. We only saw one neutron star. Okay, here is the reason why it's such a beautiful system. Now, I said, if there are two stars going around, then the velocity is Doppler shifted. The radial velocity is Doppler shifted. So you say from the shift in the period or the wavelength of some spectroscopic line emitted by the star, I determine what V over C is. Ah, you are not determining V over C. You are determining V sine I, because you don't know whether the orbit with respect to you, whether the orbit is in this plane or the orbit is in this plane or the orbit is in this plane. Where I is the angle of inclination of your line of sight with the plane of the orbit. That we don't know in Kepler problem. Because we do not know that, you cannot solve for the second mass. You knew the angle, you could, but you don't know the angle. But because general relativistic effects are so important, there are many more equations. In fact, there are far more equations than unknowns. So you can solve for everything. One of the things they solved for Hulse and Taylor was the mass of the companion. And the mass of the companion also turned out to be 1.4 solar mass. It had to be a neutron star. So that is how we know that although we don't see it, you know the mass of the companion star to 3 decimal place accuracy. Okay? Therefore, now we are getting greedy. So if you have 2 neutron stars going around each other with an orbital period of 7 hours, then maybe gravitational radiation is also important. Why fool around with this precessing ellipse and so on, which are small departures from Newtonian theory? What about gravitational radiation, which doesn't exist in Newtonian theory? So let us now recall what we discussed when we discussed radiation from an accelerated charge. We wrote down this expression for the intensity of radiation per unit time. The first term is the electric dipole. That intensity is proportional to the square of the second time derivative of the dipole moment. The last term is the magnetic dipole radiation. And the middle term is the electric quadrupole radiation, which is proportional to the square of the third time derivative of the quadrupole moment. Well, we also said that electric quadrupole radiation is very, very weak because C to the power 5 is in the denominator. But it's important if dipole radiation is absent. We also noted that if angular momentum of the system is conserved, then you will find that this magnetic dipole radiation is also absent because the magnetic moment can be related to the angular momentum, whose second time derivative is zero if angular momentum is conserved. Now let's go to gravitating system, 2 masses instead of a charge. Just like in Maxwell's theory, the conservation of mass prohibits monopole radiation. And just as in Maxwell's theory, the conservation of momentum of the center of mass permits dipole radiation. Therefore, the first order radiation in gravity, by the way, the absence of, please remember the following theorem we proved. We proved the theorem that if I have an assembly of charges, then if the ratio of the charge to the mass of the particle is the same for all particles, E over M is the same for all the particles, then we can take out E over M out to the summation, and then what remains is the center of mass coordinate, and therefore, since the center of mass is not accelerating, its second time derivative is zero, therefore, we said that if E over M ratio is the same, dipole radiation will not exist. Can I make a similar statement for gravity? Yes, I can. Since we discussed this while discussing Einstein's theory, there are 2 masses in the case of Maxwell's theory, there is a radiation, there is a charge. An electron has an electric charge as well as a mass. In the case of gravity, the charge, equivalent of charge, is the inertial mass. The equivalent of mass is the gravitational mass. So this replaces E over M. E over M in gravitation theory is replaced by the ratio of the inertial mass to the gravitational mass. Since the inertial mass to gravitational mass is the same for all bodies, you can take it out of the summation, and just as we did before, you conclude, therefore, if the center of mass momentum is conserved, then you cannot have dipole radiation. Okay? So it's a very beautiful argument. Okay. So now, what you are left with is gravitational radiation due to the quadrupole moment is the lowest order radiation. And the energy radiated per unit time is equal to G over 45 C to the power 5 Q triple dot whole squared. So the radiation will be proportional to the sixth power of the frequency, because each time derivative will give me omega. And we said this radiation is exceedingly weak because C to the power 5 comes in the denominator. It does even in electromagnetic theory, but in electromagnetic theory, in majority of situations, we do have dipole radiation. So we are not dependent on quadrupole radiation. Okay? But here you are. Now, what is the power radiated? What is the analog of Larmor's formula? The power radiated by a charge is 2 by 3, 2 E squared by C cubed. Square of the acceleration. So what is the formula corresponding to that? Corresponding formula is this. Instead of D double dot whole squared, you have Q triple dot whole squared, where Q is the quadrupole moment, which is 3x alpha x beta minus delta alpha beta x gamma, okay? So the quadrupole moment is 3 cos squared theta minus 1 type of thing, right? The quadrupole moment, because it's cos squared theta, it will change twice when I change omega from 0 to pi. Now let the two stars have masses m1 and m2, and let the relative elliptical orbit is described by R is A into 1 minus E divided by 1 plus E cosine psi, where A is the semi-major axis, E is the eccentricity, and psi is the polar angle, and R is the radius vector. This is very straightforward thing when you go from a two-body problem to an equivalent one-body problem. So you look in Goldstein or book like that, you'll get this formula, okay? Now one can, given this dependence of R on eccentricity and the semi-major axis, you can now calculate the quadrupole moment using the formula that I gave in the previous slide. X alpha, X beta minus X gamma, delta alpha, okay, fine. And this is the result you get. The luminosity of gravitational radiation, which is the energy radiated per unit time, is given by m1 squared m2 squared into m1 plus m2 divided by the fifth power of the semi-major axis. Write it down. Multiplied by a certain function F of the eccentricity E, and that function is this. Please write it down. I'll leave this slide on for a couple of seconds. This is a very straightforward derivation. You'll find it in all books. Okay. So the important thing to appreciate here is that the luminosity of gravitational radiation depends on 1 over the fifth power of the semi-major axis. Therefore, it is only going to be important if A is very small. If A is very large, it's extremely unimportant. And in our binary pulsar that we are discussing, A is small. A is only one solar radius. In one solar radius, there are two stars of the solar mass going around each other with an orbital velocity of something like 346 kilometers per second, quite fast. Please also notice that the luminosity of gravitational radiation is extremely sensitive to the eccentricity E. So if E is large, if the orbit is eccentric to a high degree, then the luminosity will be more. If the orbit is circular, the luminosity is much less. What does this function look like? Very simple. It just increases very rapidly as you go from eccentricity 0 to eccentricity of 1. You notice that it increases by a factor of 1,000 by the time you come to eccentricity. And the binary pulsar 0.7, which is over there. Why does the luminosity of gravitational radiation depend so sensitively on the eccentricity? Let's try to understand the underlying physics. It's very, very simple. It's the same in electromagnetism. This is because the power radiated is sensitive to acceleration. Acceleration is change of velocity. And higher the eccentricity, more is the change in velocity. And at what point will the velocity change be maximum? Near the perihelion. That's when the velocity changes is the maximum. So the most pronounced, the place where the change in velocity is most pronounced is of course the periastron of the orbit. Larger the eccentricity, closer the stars are at the periastron, and greater is the acceleration. Isn't it? Please remember, both the stars are going around the common center of mass. So the orbit is like this. Orbit is like this. When star 1 is here, star 2 is here. When it is here, when it's here. So at the periastron, which is the distance of shortest distance from the center of mass, that's when you're going to have the most dramatic changes in velocity. So that's a physical understanding of why the gravitational radiation luminosity is so sensitive to eccentricity. Now, what is the spectrum of this radiation? Please remember that gravitational radiation is not dipole radiation. In the case of dipole radiation, the frequency of radiation was exactly the same as the frequency of the orbit. But quadrupole radiation is not occurring at that frequency, but twice that frequency. Quadrupole, 3 cos squared theta minus 1. It changes from pole to equator, again it will change. So there are 4. No, that is quadrupole, right? That's what you mean by quadrupole. So the symmetry is different from symmetry of dipole. Dipole is symmetric under rotation by 180 degrees. A quadrupole is symmetric under rotation by 90 degrees. Therefore, for a circular orbit, the power radiated is at the second harmonic of the fundamental frequency. So if two stars are going around at the period omega, frequency omega, the frequency of radiation is 2 omega. That is true of any quadrupole radiation. Now, but if the orbit is highly eccentric, then you'll find higher harmonics will be present. Remember, in the case of electromagnetism also we had, in the case of relativity, you had higher harmonics coming in. Remember? And there, because in the case of relativity, that arises due to beaming effect and things like that. And quantum mechanically, we said the orbits are no longer, I mean, the Landau levels are no longer equally spaced. Therefore, you have higher harmonics. But here, please notice that in a highly eccentric orbit, the spectrum will consist not only of fundamental, but higher harmonics. And like in the case of relativistic particle radiating electromagnetic radiation, here also in a highly eccentric orbit, much of the radiation radiated intensity will be in the higher harmonics. Same thing. Remember there we said much of the intensity will be at gamma cube times the fundamental frequency. Okay. Now, one of the consequences of the two bodies emitting gravitational radiation is that the orbit has to shrink. So that energy radiated has to come only from the quadrupole moment, right? Or the third time derivative of the quadrupole moment. So if you think about it, go back to the expression of the quadrupole moment, then you see that the orbit has to shrink. What is the rate of change of the semi-major axis due to gravitational radiation? The total energy is 1/2 g m1 m2 divided by the separation, which is the semi-major axis. Why 1/2? Virial theorem, remember? Gravitational total energy is 1/2 the gravitational potential energy. The rate of change of the semi-major axis, dA by dt, is given by the expression shown in the second yellow box. It's proportional to the square of the semi-major axis and the luminosity of gravitational radiation. More the energy radiated per unit time, the more rapidly the orbit will shrink. Common sense tells you that's the way it ought to be. Now, if you now use this expression for the total energy, then dA by dt is equal to 1 over A cubed. dE by dt is proportional to 1 over A to the power 5. The luminosity of gravitational radiation is proportional to 1 over 5th power of the semi-major axis. The rate at which the semi-major axis shrinks is proportional to 1 over A cubed. So, like in a pulsar slowing down, P dot is B squared divided by P. Initially, it will slow down very fast and then slower and slower. Here, it is the opposite. The orbit will initially shrink very slowly, and then as A becomes smaller and smaller, it will shrink. And finally, the two stars will coalesce. Please also notice that as the orbit is shrinking, the eccentricity will also decrease. Because we said much of the radiation comes from when the star is at the periastron. So as a result of that, the eccentricity E will change with time. dE by dt is proportional to 1 over A dA by dt. So as the orbit shrinks, it also becomes more and more circular. So our binary pulsar, after 100 million years or 200 million years, when it is about to merge and produce a burst of gravitational waves, as we saw 2 years ago, its orbit would have been circular, although initially it was eccentric. The first evidence of gravitational radiation was provided by the Hulse-Taylor pulsar. What is shown in the figure is on the y-axis, you have cumulative, well, don't worry about what is actually plotted in an experimental graph. What you are trying to measure with the binary pulsar, if the orbit shrinks, the orbital period will decrease, going faster and faster. If the orbit does not shrink at all, the orbital period will remain the same. And what you will have, x-axis is of course time, what you will have is a horizontal line, zero orbital decay. In other words, the orbital period does not change with time at all. But if there is gravitational radiation, the orbit will have to shrink, and therefore the orbital period will have to decrease. And it will have to decrease according to the solid line, which is the line predicted by general relativity. And the points are the observed points of the Hulse-Taylor pulsar. It was discovered in 1974, and by 1995, which is over there, it was very clear that the shrinking of the orbit of the binary pulsar by about 7 millimeters a day. Here are two neutron stars going around a common center of mass, separated by a distance of about 1 million kilometers. The orbit is shrinking by 7 millimeters every day, which is a huge shrinking of the orbit. Okay. The gravitational radiation intensity is so weak that you cannot detect this gravitational wave sitting here on Earth. But because you can measure periods very, very accurately in astronomy, because frequencies can be measured very, very accurately by radio astronomers, you can measure the shrinking of the orbit very accurately. So the observed change in the orbital period, P dot, divided by the predicted change in the orbital P dot by general relativity is 0.997 plus or minus 0.002. And so you had to give a Nobel Prize. And when they gave a Nobel Prize, this time they didn't leave out the student. So Hulse was also included in the Nobel Prize, happily. Okay? So the terrible mistake they made in not giving it to Jocelyn Bell was somewhat rectified much later. Well, 6 years later. 20 years later. I mean, the prize was given, prize for the original pulsar was given in 73. This was given in 94. So 20 years later. The binary pulsar was discovered in 1974. In year 2002, long after the binary pulsar, a second binary pulsar was discovered. Two neutron stars going around each other. But this time, fortunately, both the neutron stars are beaming towards us. So you could see both the neutron stars functioning as a pulsar. One doesn't matter, let's call them A and B, okay? Both are functioning as a pulsar. The thing I want you to appreciate is that the orbital period is a ridiculously small number of 2 hours. I mean, 7 hours was staggering, but can you imagine two neutron stars going around each other orbital period of 2 hours? So you can imagine how much stronger the relativistic corrections will be for this thing. One of the things that was measured with this pulsar is what is known as Shapiro time delay. Now, this was first observed by radio astronomers a long time ago when they sent a radar signal from the Earth using a large 1,000 feet radio telescope in Arecibo. They sent a radio signal and bounced it off the surface of Mercury, and also bounced it off the surface of Venus. So you detect the signal as it comes back. And then what you measure is the time it took for you to go and come back. Now you'll say, well, what's the big deal? I know the distance to Mercury. I know light travels at 300,000 kilometers a second, so I know exactly when the signal should come back. But you forget that the travel time is affected by gravity. Why is it affected by gravity? Because light travels slower in a gravitational field. Is that possible? Can light travel slower? Yes, it can. Because as seen by a distant observer, dr by dt is c into 1 minus 2 gm by rc squared, which is less than c. Remember, locally, this was one of the stipulations by Einstein. Locally, special relativity must always be correct. So a local observer will say, no, I am going at the speed of light, as I should. But a distant observer will say, no, you're going slower because gravity has slowed down light. So gravity not only bends light, but it also slows down light, as seen by a distant observer. So what is plotted on the y-axis here is the time delay, that is, you have an expected time in which you expect the signal to come back. Delta t is the deviation from that. As a function of time, what you would find is initially there will be no change at all. And then as you come closer and closer, when Mercury is as shown in that figure there, the trajectory of the electromagnetic radiation is going very close to the sun, which is where the influence of the gravity of the sun will be most pronounced. And therefore, the time delay will increase. And then Mercury has gone to the other side, and then the time delay will decrease. And then finally, there'll be no time delay. So what you would expect is this. But actually, that's not what you would expect, because right in the middle, when Mercury has to go from the right in that figure to left in the figure, in between, it will be behind the sun. So it will be eclipsed by the sun. So you will miss a little bit of data during that time. So what you expect to see is that blue line on either side of the eclipse. That's what you expect to see. And relativity has a clear prediction to make about this time delay, because you know the mass of the sun and you know the distance r from the sun. This was first measured by Shapiro. That's a mistake there, sound Shapiro. Shapiro, a radio astronomer in MIT. And what he found was that the measured delay divided by the predicted delay due to general relativity was 0.9 plus or minus 0.2. Very good, but not so spectacularly good as for the Hulse-Taylor pulsars. Again, power has gone. Okay, fine. And here is the observational result from the double pulsar, superimposed on the red line, which is the prediction of general relativity or the data points. You've got to admit, it's a spectacular confirmation. So what you find is that the ratio of the predicted to observed is 1.009. Not 0.9, but 1.009. So that was a very new confirmation. So let's go back to our precessing ellipse. In the case of Mercury, it is 0.00159 degrees per year. This is the total precession. Most of it is due to perturbations from outer planets. There's only some very small amount which is due to general relativity. Whatever it is, that's the measured thing. Let's compare it to the Hulse-Taylor binary pulsar. It is 4.2 degrees per year. For the double pulsar, you know, put on your seat belts and hang on. It is 17 degrees per year. So the orbit of the double pulsar will precess by 360 degrees in your lifetime. And that precession was measured almost as soon as it was discovered. So the discovery paper, you didn't have to wait for several years, like in the case of the Hulse-Taylor pulsar. very discovery paper itself, they could detect the precession of the ellipse. So this table summarizes this. Let's not worry about it. The important thing I want you to appreciate is, in the case of solar system, the various predictions of general relativity was verified at a few percent level. It was fine because it's better than nothing. With the Hulse-Taylor pulsar, it was verified to a much higher accuracy of 0.2% level. In the case of the double pulsar, it was verified to 0.05% accuracy. Right? As I said, the shrinking of the orbit is an enormous 7 millimeters a day. Now, the Hulse-Taylor binary pulsar will coalesce after about 10 to the power 8 years, because you can calculate that. We have the formula, we wrote down the formula. The double pulsar naturally will coalesce much faster because the starting orbit itself is much. Now, just before the two neutron stars merge, there'll be a burst of gravitational waves. Will there be gravitational waves after the two neutron stars merge? We don't know. We will know in the next 10 years or so with the LIGO upgrade. Now, as I said in the very first slide, such a burst of gravitational waves was detected on 17th of August, and that's what you see over there. But what you see there is the frequency of the gravitational rays is increasing with time. This is as it should, because with time, the orbital separation is getting smaller and smaller. Therefore, the frequency of the radiation, which is the second harmonic of this fundamental, will also increase with time because the orbit is getting shrinking, right? And this is all noise. The only reason you should believe this is that this behavior is exactly as it was predicted theoretically for two neutron stars. And one of the persons who did that, my former colleague from the Raman Institute, who is now on the faculty here, Dr. Iyer, he was involved in this takes years and years and years and years of hard work, extremely hard work. And so that theoretical prediction was precisely observed. And that's the only reason you should believe in gravitational waves. Because you see, you're really digging some faint signal from noise. And the confidence really comes from the fact that the modeling had predicted this. Now, one very special thing, although gravitational waves were detected earlier, 1.5 years earlier, from two coalescing black holes, this was not the first detection. What was special about this was, immediately after that, from the same portion of the sky, a gamma ray burst was detected. And then afterwards, the gamma rays disappeared, X-rays appeared, then visible light appeared, then radio waves appeared. So there was an afterglow of the gamma ray burst. And that is shown in this picture. This is the gravitational wave burst occurring at a certain time. A little later, the integral satellite detected a burst of gravitational waves. And if you are not convinced with the strength of the signal, the Fermi telescope, there's a clear signal-to-noise ratio, is loud and clear, there's a gravity. So we know that when two neutron stars merge, not only they produce gravitational waves, they also produce a gamma ray burst. We don't have time now to discuss because I want to pursue a different aspect of the story. We know at least, we have known gamma ray bursts for about 30 years. Some are in our galaxy, but most of them are at cosmological distances. How they are produced has been very controversial. But one of the models suggested by Martin Rees in the very beginning and then pursued by Ramesh Narayan and his collaborators and so on later on, was that it may be due to two neutron stars merging and coalescing. Whether this is the general explanation for all gamma ray bursts, we don't know. But we certainly know that in this case, two neutron stars which merged did produce a gamma ray burst. Okay. Now, what happens to the two neutron stars after they merge? We don't know as yet. Why don't we know? Because as the two neutron stars come closer and closer together, the frequency of gravitational waves was increasing, as you saw. And at the moment, LIGO is only sensitive up to a certain frequency. So after it is upgraded, it will be able to go to higher frequencies. And then you hopefully, in the next 10 years or so, you will be able to follow the gravitational radiation all the way up to the actual coalescence. And then you will know what happens after that. Please remember that as the two neutron stars come really close to one another, there'll be tidal distortions of the two neutron stars. Now, as we saw, neutron star matter is very stiff. It has a solid crust. Will it tidally distort? How will it distort? Therefore, the tidal distortion that one hopefully will be able to measure after the LIGO update detects such a merger will tell you about the equation of state of the interior of neutron stars. So it's a very exciting prospect. So the future mergers, if you can follow it all the way, which will tell you deviations from a point mass approximation to tidal distortions, will tell you about the interior, physics of the interior of neutron stars. At the moment, we have a lot of conjectures, but this will be a clear thing. Okay, fine. Will the result be a black hole? Well, let's say two neutron stars of 1.4 solar mass merge, and then the merged system, let us say, has two solar mass or 2.5 solar mass. And the question is, what is the maximum allowed mass of a neutron star, which we discussed in the previous lecture? We can only say it is around two solar mass at the moment. We can't say exactly what it is because it's very hard. But we don't know till this large hadron collider results start coming in. We don't know what is the internuclear potential at very short distances and very high energy. Will this neutron, will this black hole be surrounded by a torus of neutron-rich matter producing a lot of gold and platinum? We don't know as yet. Okay? So all we can say is exciting times are ahead. So now, the remaining minutes, I want to drop this story of using a binary neutron star system as a laboratory for testing various predictions of general relativity, and let's go back and discuss something else, namely the rotational history of the firstborn neutron star in the binary, because that will be the subject of the next lecture. So let's prepare the ground for the next lecture. The firstborn neutron star has experienced all kinds of interesting history because the companion star evolved, transferred more mass, and all sorts of things. The second-born neutron star didn't experience any interesting history because as soon as it was born, either the binary disrupted, or even if it didn't disrupt, the rest of the star is gone. So you have two pieces of rock going around each other. They cannot influence each other than through gravity. But let's discuss the rotational history of the firstborn neutron star. As we said, the firstborn neutron star experiences the stellar wind from the evolving companion. Now, it is not obvious that the stellar wind will actually fall into the neutron star, onto the surface of the neutron star. So imagine, I'm looking here because imagine where this projector is, that there is a ceiling fan. And I throw ping pong balls at it, stream of ping pong balls. This is the stellar wind from the companion coming. So when the fan is spinning fast, or the rate at which I throw ping pong ball is not sufficiently large, then what would you expect? These ping pong balls will be just thrown away by the fan. Fine? Good. But I'm throwing the ping pong balls radially, which means with zero angular momentum. But the ping pong balls will go off with angular momentum. Where did that angular momentum come from? The propeller which hit it gave it that angular momentum. Therefore, the propeller has to slow down. If matter is expelled by the propeller, then the propeller has to slow down, because you have to produce the angular momentum has to be conserved, right? Fine. So the same thing happens electromagnetically. Our propeller is the magnetic field lines anchored to the surface of the neutron star. As the neutron star rotates, the magnetic field lines rotate. We discussed that before. What is falling in is charged particles. Therefore, the magnetic field will have something to say. So the magnetic field exerts an electromagnetic torque on the incoming matter. And therefore, it will influence the rotation of the neutron star itself. But when the companion fills the Roche lobe, I'm not sending throwing in billiard balls. I am having a hose pipe. And there is a gush of water coming onto the propeller. And this time, the matter will get through the magnetic field lines and fall onto the neutron star. And this time, it is bringing in angular momentum, binary angular momentum. Therefore, it will spin up the neutron star. Therefore, you would expect, on very simple grounds, that the first-born neutron star will experience both spin down as well as spin up before the second star gives up its ghost and explodes as a supernova explosion. So let us look at this carefully now. The physics is very simple and very beautiful. Firstly, imagine matter from the companion star is coming in an idealized picture that I have drawn in the equatorial plane. Now what is shown here is the neutron star with its magnetic field. The first thing to appreciate is that at a certain distance from the neutron star, the magnetic field will say stop. At what distance will it say stop? At a distance where the energy density of the magnetic field, B squared over 8 pi, becomes equal to the kinetic energy density of the incoming matter. So magnetic field says, your free ride cutting across field lines is over. From now on, Lorentz force V cross B is going to be important. And the matter now attaches itself to the field line and it will co-rotate. This is how we form the co-rotating magnetosphere of pulsars, right? Fine. Therefore, there is a radius which is known as the Alfvén radius. The Swedish physicist Alfvén. He got a Nobel Prize for some of these predictions long before neutron star. It was all done in the context of the sun. Radius at which the magnetic pressure balances ramp pressure. I leave it as a very simple exercise for you to show that that radius will be proportional to b to the power 4 over 7, r to the power 12 over 7, inversely as the m dot whole squared, where m dot is the rate of accretion of mass, dm by dt, the number of grams that fall onto the neutron star per unit time. Please do this. These crazy powers come simply because a dipole magnetic field decreases as 1 over r cubed. Therefore, b squared over 8 pi will decrease as 1 over r to the power 6. So, if you do this algebra properly, you should be able to derive this expression. Forget about the details. I want you to appreciate that this Alfvén radius, the radius at which the magnetic field says stop and follow me, is larger if B is larger, as it should be. and smaller as m dot increases. If this hose pipe, there's very little water coming out of it, it will not compress the magnetic field very much. But if the pressure of the matter is very large, because m dot is very large, then it will compress, or a smaller radius only, magnetic field will say stop. So I want you to notice that B comes in the numerator and the rate of accretion comes in the denominator. So if you do this calculation and get the powers right, I'll be happy. But at least make sure B comes in the numerator and m dot comes in the denominator. So that's it. So the alpha n radius is proportional to B to the power 4 over 7 and m dot whole squared in the denominator. Now, let's go back to Kepler's laws. What does Kepler's law say? It says that the square of the period is proportional to whatever, right? This can be written as a period, and that is the semi-major axis. So I've shown three circles there. The middle circle, which is in green, is the co-rotation radius. It is the radius at which the Keplerian period is equal to the period of rotation of the central body. It is the radius at which we park INSAT satellites. The orbital period of INSAT is 24 hours. You can only do that at that and that radius alone. If you try to put INSAT in an orbit at a larger radius, then the centrifugal force will be larger than gravity and INSAT will fly off. If you try to put INSAT at a smaller radius than the co-rotation radius, then gravity will be larger than centrifugal force and INSAT will fall back to the ground. Therefore, co-rotation is possible at only that radius, which is the radius at which the Keplerian period is equal to the period of rotation of the central body. Is that concept clear? Fine. Because in our usual Kepler problem, we don't care whether the sun is rotating or not. But here we do care about the rotation of the central body because that's what we are discussing, the rotational history of the neutron star. And the co-rotation radius is proportional to the rotation rate of the central body to the power 2 by 3. This is just Kepler's laws. All right. Now, I already said this. I said during the weak stellar wind phase, the neutron star will be spun down because of the propeller effect, and during the heavy accretion phase, it will be spun up. Now, please notice, you have to now ask the question, matter is coming in from the companion. Will it be thrown back or will it fall in? Will it slow down the neutron star or spin up the neutron star? That depends upon the following. The red circle is the alpha n radius. That is the radius at which the magnetic field stops the infall. That radius may or may not be greater than the co-rotation radius, because the co-rotation radius is determined uniquely by the rotation of the central body. There's nothing to do with what the companion is doing. So the point is that if the alpha n radius is greater than the co-rotation radius, which is the green circle, you can't force matter to co-rotate at a radius larger than the co-rotation radius. It will be thrown out and the neutron star will be slowed down. But on the other hand, if the magnetic field is weak or if the accretion rate is very strong, large, and the alpha n radius is smaller than the co-rotation radius, then the matter, once arrested by the magnetic field, can now flow along the field lines and fall on the neutron star and spin it up. Therefore, whether or not the neutron star slows down due to this incoming matter or spins up depends on whether the alpha n radius is greater or less. Star will be happiest when these two radii are equal. If it is matter is thrown out, the star will slow down. As the star slows down, the co-rotation radius will go out. Or the other way around, the happy situation will be, an equilibrium situation will be, given the magnetic field and given the rate of rotation of the star, the only choice the star has is to adjust its rotation rate to a value where its rotation rate is equal to the Keplerian period, the radius at which it is orbiting. So, to skip the story, go rapidly, the neutron star will experience several phases. In the first phase, the newly born, first born neutron star doesn't know anything about the companion. It is just functioning as the pulsar, like Crab pulsar or Vela pulsar. It is losing energy because it's emitting electromagnetic radiation, which carries away energy and angular momentum. It will function as a normal pulsar. But as the companion evolves and the matter enters the light cylinder, this dynamo will get shorted and it will no longer function as a pulsar. So you enter the phase. So what is shown here is, if I plot the period of rotation of the first-born neutron star as a function of its age, for many thousands of years, it will slow down. It will slow down like pulsars are slowing down. Very simple. In the second phase, when the magnetic pressure makes the incoming matter co-rotate with the star, and if the Alphan radius is greater than the co-rotation radius, then this propeller will expel the matter, and therefore the matter will carry away the angular momentum, which is coming at the expense of the angular momentum of the central body. And in a very short time of 10,000 years or so, the neutron star will be braked to a period of hundreds of seconds, maybe even thousands of seconds. So what you find is that when the stellar wind from the companion comes and a magnetic field acts as a propeller, the neutron star will be spun down to a period of many hundreds or thousands of seconds. Do we see such neutron stars? We see hundreds of such neutron stars. Most pulsars are spinning with a period of 1 second. But the X-ray emitting pulsars are spinning with a period of 800 seconds, 900 seconds, 600 seconds. How did they get to such large period? Because of that electromagnetic torque. We now know a large number of them. And then the phase three is, as the star slows down, the co-rotation radius will become larger than the Alphan radius. This time matter will fall onto the neutron star. And because the incoming matter brings with it angular momentum, it will spin up the star. It will spin up the star till an equilibrium period is reached. That's what is shown here. So going back to our picture, before that, do we observe this spin-up? We observe the spin-up. Many of the X-ray pulsars are spinning up. In other words, the period is not increasing with time like for Crab pulsar or Vela pulsar. There, it is losing energy and therefore it has to slow down. Here you find it is actually spinning up. It is spinning up because the matter that is falling on it, which is responsible for the X-ray radiation, is also bringing in angular momentum, and that is causing the neutron star to spin up. So we have direct experimental. So finally, what will happen is the companion star will become a giant. It will overflow its Roche lobe, and this time matter, magnetic field will just be squeezed. You don't care because M dot is in the denominator. You don't care how strong the magnetic field is, and the neutron star will be dramatically spun up. And then at this point, the companion star explodes, leaving behind the second neutron star. And then what happens to the first neutron star? Nothing anymore. There is nobody to bother it. Nobody to either slow it down or spin it up. So it remembers, I'm a rotating magnetized neutron star, so I have to work as a pulsar. So that first-born neutron star functions as a pulsar twice. In the beginning, it functioned as a pulsar because that was the only thing there. Nothing was happening to the companion. It is again functioning as a pulsar because the story is over. The binary story is over. So next lecture, we will discuss these pulsars. And I've called this as a recycling of the first-born neutron star. Okay? So the first-born neutron star is first spun down to hundreds, perhaps thousands of seconds, and then spun up due to mass transfer in the later phase. So in the next lecture, we will revisit the Hulse-Taylor pulsar, and we'll discuss why it is behaving in such a peculiar fashion. Now let's forget it's a binary, all this general relativity and all that. Let us remember what we actually see. A pulsar which is spinning at a period of 59 milliseconds. So you would all say it is a young pulsar, probably born 2,000, 3,000 years ago. But how come its magnetic field is 10 to the power 10 Gauss and not 10 to the power 16, 13 Gauss? You'll say, no, it's very old. So which is true? Is it young or old? So that is the mystery that attracted me to astronomy, okay? So most of the things I will discuss in the next lecture and the next lecture are crazy ideas of mine. So I leave it to you to decide whether to believe in them or not.